should wear a warning. It's dangerous. I'm flying. There's no escape. I can't wait. I need a hit. Baby, give me it. You're dangerous. I'm loving it. You really can't come down. Losing my hands when I'm down and round. To you.
Hey, baby, 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 hey, baby Hey, baby, I'm in the club hollering. Now when I holler, hey, baby, I'm finna get my groove on. It's so hot up in the club that I ain't got no shoes on. Holding up a big stack of them hunnids in a rubber band. God don't ask me for no cash, cause I'm not that other man. We say when clubs get cropped, what? Hey, baby, let it play, that's my song, turn it up. Okay, you wanna know what we say when clubs get cropped, what? Hey, baby, let it play, that's my song, turn it up. Okay, you wanna know what we say in the club? Hey, baby, white folks, gangsters in the club. Hey, baby, stunting with a stack of them dubs. Hey, baby, riding in the lap with a mug. Hey, baby, I'm in the club, hollering. Hey, baby, hey, baby, hey, baby, hey, baby, hey, baby, hey, baby, I'm in the club, hollering. Hey, baby. Hey baby, hey baby, hey baby, hey baby, hey, I'm in the club.
That's OG. Yeah. Were you even born? JK. Happy Friday, y'all. Welcome to FYG Live, 20 minutes of insights and inspiration for students, educators, and parents. I'm one of your hosts, Charlie Kane, and with me today is a music tastemaker, Kayleen.
Yeah, y'all. Charlie, hello.
Hello. Happy Friday.
Yes. It's like, I feel like we say this every time, but on Monday we're like, where'd the weekend go? And then Friday we're like, where'd the week go? Sound like old people or something. And like I don't know, never mind. Today, I want to talk about our guest. Let me move on from that. Today's guest is a bespoke streetwear designer and the creative director of the design duo Yaito. He's known for creating amazing one-of-one pieces with a specialty in distressing denim. His work has earned him collaborations with Levi's, Awake New York, and Tommy Hilfiger. And he has craft pieces for Rockefeller, co-founder Biggs Burke, Kristen Crowley, and Ale Lee May. I always like that name because it sounds like a radio name, like Kayleen Green or Charlie Kane or our guest today. I don't want to say his name yet. I don't want to give it away. But Ale Lee May and more. So, Charlie, tell me about, like, what's going on this week and, like, what we're talking about.
So this week we've been talking about resilience and how to push forward when experiencing setbacks. For a lot of entrepreneurs, especially in the fashion industry, COVID-19 has impacted sales as people's financial priorities have shifted and halted production as factories are closed or limited. But for creatives like Carlton, who doesn't concentrate on fast fashion, but are creating quality, individualized pieces, that story goes a little different. But he wasn't always in a place where he knew what to do with his degree in fashion. We're here not only to talk about Carlton's journey, but the resilience he's needed as an entrepreneur and how he thinks the fashion industry will change. So without further ado, let's welcome our guest today, Carlton. What's good? Where are you at in the world?
Hey, I'm home in my apartment / studio.
Where is home?
Home is Jamaica, Queens.
Where? All right.
Raised. Can't leave.
I feel that. So we just want to get right into it. So I know that you have an educational background in fashion. What degree did you get? What did you do with it afterwards, immediately, when you graduated? And how did you even find your footing to what you're doing?
Well, slight correction on that. I did go to school, but like literally right before I was supposed to graduate, I dropped out.
Oh, that's okay.
Like right before. It's actually crazy. So I went to school, like from high school. This story is always interesting to me because I think like over my years, I've come to realize how people have a hard time figuring out what they want to do in their lives. So I went to the High School of Art and Design in Manhattan, and it's pretty much primarily an art school. Like, if you go there, you're pretty much an artist. You have to be an artist actually to get in. And like, at the end of your sophomore year, I was 15. They literally ask you, so what do you want to do with the rest of your life? Because by the time you start your junior year, you have to go into a major. So everyone kind of breaks off into different parts of the school. And I remember saying to myself, like, man, 15, like, what am I going to do the rest of my life? And that was like such a heavy question, like, at that age. So a bunch of my friends were into art as well. And he's like, you know, you should go do this or do that or do this. So at the beginning of the year, I ended up switching majors, I think, like, three times, from, like, architecture to cartooning. And then I just ended up in fashion because it just, I don't know, I used to, like, paint on clothes and stuff. So I was like, you know, it made sense to, like, learn how to actually make them. So then I went from learning about fashion in school, in high school, then into college. And then in college, which was weird, it was around the time, like, I guess the internet started to, like, really break free. And there's a designer named Laquan Smith. He went to art design as well. And then he went to the same college as me out in Long Island. And I remember, I was like almost like to my last semester. And I had mentioned him in the school because he didn't finish either. But he was like really starting to blow up. And I remember mentioning it to one teacher, like, hey, do you remember Laquan? She's like, oh, yeah, I remember Laquan. And I was like, oh, man, he's doing so good. He's, you know, his brand is taking off. And she said, you know, he would never make it because he didn't get a degree. And I remember it just kind of taking me back. And I was just like, I don't know. It didn't feel like, I don't know. I just felt like there was nothing that needed to define what a person was going to achieve in life by, I guess, like, just this, I don't know, piece of paper and how my mind worked. So I kind of just fell back, and I ended up dropping out. Later on, me and Laquan ended up having a conversation about that. And he's, like, a huge art designer now. So, yeah, that's kind of how that goes. So I pretty much been studying fashion again since 16. I started from 16 till now. It's been almost going on 14 years.
So when you say you had that conversation and you fell back as far as not finishing your degree, was it because he made that comment of like thinking that you needed a degree to make it?
Yeah, I guess it put like a bad taste in my mouth. That was like the first thing. And then as that semester was going on, I started to realize, like, we weren't learning anything. We were pretty much at that point where...
Creating your thesis? Your collection?
Yeah. I was just there pretty much. And then in the back of my mind, I guess from that last comment, and then I started to feel like, well, I don't feel like I need to... Like, I don't need to pay, because I was paying for school. I'm like, why am I paying to prove that I know what I've already learned? It just kind of didn't make sense to me. So I just took that money that I was going to use for school, and I was like, I had already started my own little brand. I started putting money into that. It just felt like it made more sense, which was funny because a lot of the kids, like, there were other kids in school at that time that could sew better than me, but they couldn't illustrate better than me. But, which was funny, a lot of them ended up turning around and, like, they went to, like, intern for another company or they worked for somebody, and a lot of them just stopped being in the fashion. Because from how my perspective of how things work, when you're a creative, it's kind of hard to transition from, like, being a creator to starting a business. Like, the real life experience is what really kicks off things to really push you to be motivated to do it. You know, working for somebody else kind of sets you back, in my opinion, for you to be able to, like, make those mistakes. And then at the same time, those mistakes can turn into, like, triumphs because you're not afraid to, like, fall short sometimes. So I guess, like, in the best way, like, for me personally, like, not finishing school and going through those, like, that hardship, it really built my character to, like, do what I do today, pretty much.
For sure. Yeah, it's a good point that you brought up about how school sometimes, like they'll teach you, like, the technical things that you may need to know, but they're not teaching you what we call, like, power skills.
Right.
And that's, like, how do you talk to people? Even, like, things like, how do you pitch? Are you able to, when you do hit a bump, are you able to find a creative solution? Like, it's things like that that school isn't necessarily teaching you, but it's stuff that you get in real life, like what you were saying.
Mm-hmm.
So did you, when you had dropped out of school and you said you already had, like, a little brand, how did you, like, find your footing? Was there ever a point where you weren't doing any design and you're just like trying to figure out, should I even utilize my degree, or did you always know that you were going to be a designer?
Well, I always knew I was going to be a creative. I had stopped designing for a while after school. Like I said, I took some of the money and tried to put it into my brand, but I was young and I was still like living the young life, having fun, partying, you know, just not really focused. So I just stopped. I stopped everything completely. I had like a completely different lifestyle at the time. That really made things a lot rougher. But for some reason, I just always knew I was going to be a creative. Like, I never really, like, although my life had changed completely and I wasn't doing anything in my, a lot of people probably said I wasn't doing anything. I always knew I was a creative, though. So, like, when I jumped back into gear, I could pretty much say, like, I stopped creating in 2011. And then I jumped back into it more so in, like, 2015. But I just jumped right back into the same seat. And then the only thing is, like, I had the knowledge I had once had in school, I started to really, like, apply it. And then I started to learn more on my own with those things. And then it kind of jumped into another gear by that time. But I always knew I was going to be exactly where I was today. It was one of those things where I felt like there was no other plan. It was like, I'm just either going to do this or there's nothing else.
Let's talk about more of that, like, I guess, lifestyle. So you always knew that you were going to be a creative. What was it, or what is it about being a creative that really interests you? And then what was a thing that kind of, like, switched your mode from, you know, maybe not taking the craft seriously, and that's why you took a little break, or you said you weren't focused. So what was that thing that made you focused?
I guess it was more so. So it was two things. Like coming, I come from like a Caribbean background as well, and they are not big on like art. I mean, I think a lot of cultures are like that sometimes. Like, what do you mean you're gonna be an artist? Like, yeah, right. Like, go find like a concrete job. So like living with my mom, you know, in her house, it was kind of like, yeah, you're doing what you're doing, but like, what about this? So it was like, I guess my confidence used to break a lot because I didn't feel confident in myself to do what I needed to do. But over the years, I started to build that confidence because I moved out. So, you know, things were really rough around that time. I was pretty much starting from like scratch, but I had like, because of all like, I don't want to call it like torment, but like because of that hardship she would put on me and like being in that house, by the time I had like my own space, I didn't have any money at the time, but I was so rich because I was like free. Like my thoughts, I had my own thoughts for like the first time in life. Yeah. So like my confidence was like through the roof. Like no one could really tell me anything because I didn't have like the few people that I already felt like cared about me, like beating me down almost like mentally. Mm-hmm. So I just had the freedom to just kind of like push ahead. And then I guess with that freedom came the creativity and then things just started to roll.
And I totally understand what you say about your background or your ethnicity with your parents. It is like that with a lot of minorities. I mean, I'm like the same. I was pre-med, and because that's always what my parents kind of just told me that I was going to be, you know. So I was pre-med, and I did a whole 180 and was like, I'm going to do, like, fashion journalism. And they're like, what?
Right.
I totally feel that, and I definitely had to prove myself, but that's a whole other story. But man, I lost my train of thought. So for students, say they're not able to get out of their house, you know, especially right now, and they have like big dreams for themselves. Do you have any advice on how to like build that confidence without necessarily moving out yet?
Mm-hmm. Well, what I would say is like the one thing I could have did different, I feel like, although like things were different, I could have focused more. I wasn't really focused. Like when I was young, I felt like, see, like me, there's like a fault line, I feel like, because before designing, I've always been an artist in like illustration. So like literally since I was about 5, I started drawing. And then by the time I was in, like, middle school, I had won, like, an award at NYU for, like, for this artist academy that they put together. So my confidence was just way too high in terms of, like, my artistry. By the time I was, like, ready to hit adulthood, all I knew was art, and I felt like I was so good at it, I felt like I had nothing to prove, so I was lazy. Like, oh, I'll get to it at some point. Oh, I feel like if you really love what you're, like, if you have a passion for something, work at it, like, from now. Like, I don't care if you're, like, 16, 17, 18. Like, put your foot down and put on the gas. Because, like, as a creative, I feel like it's a much harder and longer road. So the earlier you start might be the better. And then you might be able to master whatever it is that you're doing at an early age. And I feel like, trust me, I was like, as a 29-year-old, if I knew what I knew at 19, I would have been out of here a long time ago. So if you really want to focus yourself at home, just, like, buckle down, you know, put down the video games, put down anything. Like, you always have extra time. And if there's extra time, use it for the right things, pretty much. Yeah.
What would be an advice that you would give your 19-year-old self?
I don't know if I can hear that. It might be the same thing. Don't worry so much. Stop worrying about, I don't know. Well, actually, you know what? I feel like it's the same thing with what I see going on in the world today. Like, I think a lot of people are worried about the wrong things, you know, worried about relationships and love and who loves me. And I think my advice to myself would pretty much say, just love yourself. Mm. Love yourself now and find that peace within, because it'll take you much further. Because regardless of what happens, the people that come and go, like, you're still going to be okay. You're still going to make it. So, yeah, that's what I'll tell myself.
Yeah. No, that's good advice. We had a broadcast a few weeks ago with our educators and parents, and there was this an analogy that was made about, like, when you're in an airplane and they tell you when those, like, oxygen masks, like, come down, who do you put it on first? You have to put it on yourself first, other than, like, the kids or the people beside you. So it's exactly that. Like, you have to give yourself breath. You have to, like, love yourself first and take care of yourself first before you can take care of others.
Yep.
Yeah.
Valid question.
Yeah. So, you know, being an entrepreneur is tough, especially in the business of fashion, where things are saturated with fast fashion brands and just trends, like, flying left and right, drops right. being week after week. Right. How did resilience play in your company?
I think it's because of the same notion, like, pretty much telling these kids, like, things have changed so much from, like, when I got into fashion, you had to, like, you really had to know how to design. Regardless of if you moved to a direction of manufacturing at some point, like, you had to at least put together at least one of your own collections, like, during school, or, you know, you went to Central St. Martin's. Like, you had to be somewhere and actually know how to create. Now it's not that. So it's just so easy for everybody to just, you know, look to go to some type of manufacturing here, overseas, and just make. I always stuck to the idea, like, at some point, if the world stops, if I don't know, maybe I predicted this. If the world stops and manufacturing stops, who's going to make all your stuff? Like, so I always thought about that. I've said that to a million different people. And even though it was like, it takes more time to make my pieces and I don't get to sell as much, it has, like, this cult following that's starting to grow, where people really just like the authenticity. They like to see the garment being made. They want to feel it. So when, you know, when this quarantine started, I seen every other brand that I know just, like, disappear. Or people are like, yeah, I can't afford it. You know, production's not, I'm not making any money. I'm not trying to be arrogant or anything, but, like, it almost got better for me in quarantine. Like, I got more business, I got more looks. And then even the freedom of things stopping, I started to create other things. So I don't know. The idea for me is, like, as a designer, if your brand isn't built on some type of, like, model, and mine is actually designing, it won't last.
Yeah.
Yeah, easy. It's that simple for me.
Yeah. you design out of trends at all, or is it purely just creativity and what you're feeling?
Creativity. I can't even, like, when I do certain collaborations with companies, you know, they'll ask me, like, oh, can you, know, can you send us some mocks? And I'm like, I don't work like that. It's something I heard Pharrell say a while back. You know, he used to always say, like, he would never talk to someone before creating a beat, like when him and the Neptunes were produced. And he was like, yeah, I want it to sound like this. Every time he did it, it came out bad. And I was like, wow. I'm like, that's sick, because that's how I think. I never think about what I'm going to create. I'll come up with a concept like, I want to make a rug today, or I want to make this jacket, or I want to make, but then by the time I start, I want to just go with it. Like, I might pick up this fabric might turn into something else, or this shape might, and I just, it's like a free flowing idea. And then by the time I'm done, then I'm done. I don't like to think about it too much before.
Yeah. Yeah. How long did it take you, either to establish yourself or to think of the idea of doing these like one-off pieces, you know, because usually the business model is to do a collection, whether it's like a small capsule or whether it's like a larger collection. Like, what made you want to do these like one-off pieces?
I think it was more so the idea of like when Alexander McQueen died. When he passed away, I remember at the time he was like the biggest designer in the world. But he was working on, I think, maybe like 9 collections a year. And I remember them saying in my head, they were saying he just worked himself to death. Like, it was just too much. And that's how I started to think, especially when fast fashion came around. And then I saw how high fashion started to try to compete with fast fashion because things were being turned over so quick. They wanted to just have like more collections, more clothes, and there was more brands. It just became so oversaturated. To me, the only thing that made sense, it never made sense to me, was like, okay, you know, I'm going to run now. I see everyone else run, I'm going to run. I just feel like I'm going to just walk. Okay, at some point, y'all going to all get tied out and burnt out, and I'm going to just walk my way right past y'all. And that's just, I guess, the vision I've always had for myself and the brand.
Yeah. I love that, because you've just always stayed true to your design ethos, your, like, concept, and just yourself, which is... really, that's like a strong mind to have, especially not to be swayed with like what everything else is going on and what's like being, what's making money, what's popular, like who's rising up. Like, it takes a really strong mind and willpower to just be like, I'm just gonna stay in my lane that I've created and just believe in that. It's more so like really believing in yourself.
Mm-hmm. It's more so only that. I grew up in like a Christian household, and then over the years, like, I've kind of pushed into like more of a, I'm not even know what the proper term is. Like, I believe in almost every religion now, like, just taking pieces from things, because now I've come to have more of an understanding of like myself. And even with that, I've learned to like not label things, and at the same time live in a sense of freedom. Like, there is no right or wrong, there's no good or bad. It's just kind of the balance of everything and understanding. And that itself, like, it helped me take a step back from social media and feel like I had to compete. And at the same time, understanding that the person that I was 5 years ago, 10 years ago, is not the same person I am today. And the only way I got here was by going down my path. You know, I found my centering pretty much by stop worrying about the world. Like, none of this stuff ever really meant anything. And I think that's like my biggest takeaway, even like as a kid, or even talking to any kid, would say, like, don't worry about anyone. Like, there's nothing that can really damage you besides you. Like, every action or reaction is something that at the end of the day is like, it's a reflection of like who you are, and at the same time what you're comfortable with or not comfortable with. And the only person that can answer that is yourself. It always goes back to self. Like, you know, my biggest thing I say is like knowledge of self. It's part of like this religion that I'm like heavy into. You know, knowledge of self is big. Like, really understand who you are, the depth of like the person underneath it all. And that's all powered by your mind. And I feel like the more you try to understand that, you try to strip away the things that like cloud our judgment today. When you really find that person internally, you know, you're like unstoppable.
that self-discovery is real, and I feel like you summed up like the last 5 weeks of our episodes. Like, that's really tight. You mentioned social media, how you don't want to, like, how you don't get too, I guess, involved with it or caught up with it. But you've also really utilized it for your brand strategy and how to, like, market your brand. So I'm going to give some, like, scenarios. What do you think is more important for new or designers in the making when it comes to social media? Is it posting about themselves? Is it posting about the process or the concept of what they're making? Is it posting about the final product? Or who is wearing the product?
See, that's the hard part, because it's a little bit of all those things, honestly. In the stages of it, I would say it's like this. It's more, start off with the process, and then the final product, and then a little bit about yourself, and then who's it in. Because right now I'm in the stage of who's in it. You know, like, people know I can make clothes. They see the final product. They know how dope it is. Now people, like, even right now, people are learning more about me. And, you know, now I have someone that works with my brand and PR. Her main thing is, like, we have to get the garments out on more people. So it's a little bit of everything. But in the beginning, for sure, people need to see the process, and they need to understand that you have a vision and how it's executed.
So would you say that is more important than posting about yourself? Because you know how there's some people who, like, it's more so the brand is about them versus the actual thing that they're creating. Okay. Yeah.
I think it depends on who you are. I think it depends on the market you're trying to attack. And at the same time, like, what does your brand represent? Somebody like me, you know, I remember the first time I posted myself in a while. This is a while back, and no one had ever really seen me. And I posted, like, a story, and I was just showing my face. And then one kid said, "Oh, my God, I always thought you were Japanese." And I laughed, but I understood what he said, because, like, this is a book I always look into. It's a Japanese designer. And it talks about, like, the architecture and design. And some people reference Japanese culture with certain fashion in terms of technicality. They have some of the best designers. So I took that as such a high compliment, and it was funny. So to me, I always say, like, me as a person, I don't really matter. You know, if I'm creating something, like, physically, people need to see that. They need to understand that, especially in today's market. Spend your time showcasing that. You, not to be like that, but it's like, as a person, when you have a brand, you, the person, don't really matter. You're not that important.
That's true. That's true. And it's always about the message or what you've, like, created, for sure.
That's the main thing.
Yeah. Because that's what you're even, like, doing it for. You're trying to create. You're trying to get a message out. So let's concentrate on that rather than
Right. And then for me, it's better, because I think later on it's more of a story. Like, no one knows anything about, you know, Margiela, like, no one, the man. But you know everything about the brand. At some point now, you know, they just drop one of his documentaries. But, like, now that you learn a little bit about him, it's more interesting, because you've seen, like, decades of this brand, like, this story being told. But you don't know anything about the person. But it's still one of the biggest brands in the world.
That's true. If I'm, like, walking down the street, I would never know if I'm walking past, like, any of these, like, high luxury brand designers, you know? That's a good point, for sure.
Craft, not the people.
What was that?
Sounds like it's more focused on, like, the craft.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
The people.
1,000%.
Yeah. How do you think the fashion industry will change? I mean, I'm sure it's changed right now. So how have you seen it change right now and then post-COVID-19?
It's not my favorite thing to think about. I think fast fashion, I'm not going to say it's over, but I think it's almost like a reverse now. I feel like high fashion, like, let's say ready to wear, I feel like they were racing with fast fashion. Fast fashion got to stop now, because not to say, they don't know what to make, because they depended on the designers to create something, steal those ideas to create. So now it's just like a lot of people, you know, fast fashion brands, they're being exposed, because at some point you can keep selling that, but that's not going to, you know, people are not going to be buying to that. Now it's more so the market of like really the creativity. Like, you're looking at, I've had this conversation where most people already understand, you're looking at potentially another year without any type of like runway show. So you're looking at least another 3 seasons. You're talking about another, you know, almost 2 years of like people not designing anything. They're going to start looking for like capsules and then independent designers like myself to really like elevate and create, because people can't. So then it goes more into like the arts. You know, fashion is now an art again, for real, because you have so all these people, like, especially online, that are like really creative. So for me, what I see coming is like, we've seen it for like the past 2 years, a lot of big brands collaborated with small designers. I think they're going to do that times 10 now. You know, you're going to start finding a lot of new emerging designers, and you're going to see a lot of small capsule collections coming out, because that might be their only way. Like, I'm working on 2 collaborations right now, and I've already told them, don't really worry about manufacturing. I'll do it all myself.
Wow.
You know, and
Did you land those collaborations during this time, or was it even before?
This was right before we were having these conversations about certain things. And those 2 situations are like, they wanted to kind of put it on pause, but then we were just talking about certain things. I'm like, nah, just send this, and this. I'll take care of the rest. So we're able to push through. We don't know in terms of when we're going to be dropping. And then at the same time, I got in contact with other brands I'd already collaborated with, and I'm doing new stuff for them now because they're looking for new content to put out. I'm like, well, send me some stuff. I'll make this happen. So again, everything kind of plays into favor. If you can make it and create it, you can have some opportunities. The eyes out there looking. I think now they're looking more than ever for new talent.
For sure.
So,
yeah.
For sure.
Do you have, I don't know if you're in your studio space right now, but do you have anything that you can show us what you've been working on this week?
Oh, yeah.
Hold on. Charlie, that's a good question. I didn't even think about that. I feel like we get a sneak peek.
I know, I'm excited.
Into something. I've just been like listening so intently.
Well, I just did these like yesterday.
Wow.
These are these LV pillows, inspired pillows that I did. So pretty much, I had like a ton of, I'm just hugging. I had a bunch of fur left, like these faux furs that I had from last winter. And I made this Nike rug, which is gone now already. And I was like, oh, I could just kind of play with these furs. And I had this metallic fabric. It's like this this vinyl that I have bought. I was like, let me just put something together. I don't know. The idea just kind of came naturally. I can't tell you what really made it happen, but I made a bunch of these. I made this too. I made this morning. Literally, I was just like, it was like a new concept I'm trying to come up with. I'm gonna make a bunch of different versions.
Yeah.
But then I just made this. This is gonna be actually, I'll tell you guys. I'm gonna make like a jumbo size to this. Like,
wow.
Human size.
Okay.
Inside of it. So that my idea is like to really, you know how people say like you're in your bag? I'm going to like make a bag and be inside of my bag.
Yes.
So yeah. A bunch of stuff. Like I have like a couple more like pillow ideas I have. I just thought about it like while we were sitting here, I want to make some coasters. Like I'm going to just be making until we're out of here.
Yeah. Right. I love how you haven't like slowed down, but have, you know, used this time to maybe like slow down with your mind, but to go forward with creation. That's amazing to see.
It's been the only time, because before this, I was working on so many different things. It's already out there. I did a campaign. Well, I'm on a year contract with Life Water, and they had us pretty much about to start like all of our media, and then this happened. So around the time I was working on like orders, I'm working on that. I just came from Mexico shooting a commercial. I was just kind of starting to like get tired. So when this happened, my mind, like I said, I just got to slow down. I think I slept for like 3 weeks. We were just here, and I'm just like sleeping. And then I was just like, oh, I feel good now.
Yeah.
And then I just, the switch started going, and now I just like, I'm like, I can't stop.
You're so right about that, because I feel like by the end of 2019, all I kept reading and like talking about with people is like the burnout, and how I felt like all of my friends, anyone who is creative, just experienced like some kind of burnout in 2019, or how they already felt like they were burning out and the year hardly just started. So it's crazy. Like, I never really thought about the timeout that we all got to just like take care of ourselves, you know?
I think it was universal in a sense, because we all know what's going on with the planet. So for me, it was just like, as I watched, you know, the winter come to an end and spring started to come in, like, I'm literally looking outside my window, it's a bunch of trees, and I always laughed at myself. I said, wow, I feel like the energy outside is just so much better, because, like, it's less pollution going on in the world right now. The world gets to breathe a little bit while we breathe, and I feel like it's all interconnected. Like,
yeah.
You know, not to get too spiritual, but just pretty much saying, like, there's no exchange in terms of, like, you know, a lot of people say, like, man, 2020 has been, like, the worst year. I don't really believe that. I feel like it's been the best, because I don't know, turning 30, I don't think I've ever had a period of time, especially in my adulthood, where I got to stop and say, like, so what is life? Like, what is my life about? Like, what is the meaning of life itself to me? And right now, you know, everybody thought it was about chasing dollar, hustling. It's like, no, what about your loved ones? What about, you know, like, I barely get to talk to family when I'm just nonstop going. You know, you're seeing everybody, you know what's going on. A lot of people perishing. You're like, did you get to speak to the ones you love? Did you get to cherish them? Did you get to even pay attention to things that are important? Because look, at the drop of a dime, all the things we're chasing mean nothing. And you're watching the world really get to like blossom again. It's almost like freeing. You know, I don't know. It just feels like something that was very necessary. Let's just say that.
I feel you.
Yeah.
It's like but it's rare that everyone is on the, because even like, think about holidays. You got Christmas, you only have people that celebrate Christmas that really take that pause. And then like any other like religious holiday or national holiday, like it's rare that literally the entire world is just like at the same time to just be like, and it's, I'm not saying it's a good thing, but I'm just like finding the light or finding something in here that you're just like, oh, I think I told Charlie this the other day, but it's so weird that it like took a pandemic for people to actually go, how are you doing? Actually tell me how you're doing. Like, I know you've been in your head a lot, or I know this is a scary time. How are you? And people are just like caring about people again, you know?
Well, I mean, yeah, the real meaning of, I think, life, you know, you're not worrying about money and like who can buy this or who's wearing that, like whose hair is done, or who, none of these things are like mean anything in the grand scheme of things. And yeah, we're starting to really see what it all means. And it's, to me, it's kind of, it's beautiful. I think coming out of it, what I've had a conversation with a lot of people is like, I think even when we are allowed to do everything, people still won't be doing everything. Not just because you're scared, but more so just like, I don't need to be wasting my time on those things anymore. You know, I need to really keep paying attention to what matters. And that's my biggest takeaway from it, just in people. So it's beautiful to see.
Yeah. Whenever you are showing us like all the things you're working on, I have a friend who, Hector, shout out, who makes things and is, I would consider, a really beautiful and kind creator in his work and
personally,
as a human. Yeah. And so like, I know he's sitting here, like, I know he's watching probably, but I know he's like taking in the comments.
Yes.
He wants it. He wanted to take it from the screen. But Hector is someone who like works on stuff, like he's always thinking, who's always creating, I think. So like, what would you tell someone? Because earlier you were like, I think after this, people are going to be looking towards individuals more. I think after this, people are going to be looking for independent creators. So like, what would you tell Hector, who's like out here doing stuff, and he who doesn't have he's on a different level than you, but like it's still here creating and like working on stuff. Like, how do you get in the right mindset when you're just like flowing? How do you get there? What do you do? Like, just what's something you would tell someone who's like, okay, I'm doing what he's doing. I'm just creating. I'm doing it. Now what? You know?
It's like a hard question, because like for years, like this was my reality check, right? For years, I was just like, even when I got back into creating, I was just creating. I was making stuff nonstop. Nothing was really like half, like, not say things were like, my platform was growing little by little. I got one or two little looks here and there because I moved in certain circles. The thing that happened to me was I went back to work, like for real, and I didn't mean to. I ended up, this is all just the universe. In 2017, the end of 17, it was that fashion week. So September 2017, my boy called me. He's a designer too. And he's like, yo, they need some people to come do this thing with Virgil for fashion week. It was the release of his 10 pack when he did like the original release of the Nikes. And they did something for fashion week with Nike where they want to have like a bunch of people come and literally design. Like, there, you could take like an old Nike hoodie with some new apparel and chop it up and put it back together, but they needed people to sew on site. So I'm like, oh, this sounds like it's going to be interesting. And it really was. Like, I mean, it was me and I think six designers all together, but we were there just pretty much as like an atelier, like on site. Just like people were taking off sleeves, cuffs, anything, and we're sewing it all together. But we're doing like 50, 60 people in like 2 hours. Wow. And like, we're talking about, like, you're talking about a ton of garments. It was crazy. And in the midst of it, the agencies that were on site there were just a bunch of creatives like Angelo from Awake, Shaniqua Jarvis, Virgil was there, like tons of people that was in the industry. And they were like, yo, who are y'all? You know, like, we knew people around, like people coming to talk to us individually, people in that scene. And it was like, you know, it's a bunch of young black men. So they were like, okay, this is just a little different than the norm. You know, you should come work with so-and-so. I got into agency work, and I started traveling and doing stuff with Nike and working with other agencies and doing stuff with Jordan Brand. I'll say no lie, I don't know how, but like in the period of being in the agency, my brand grew like four times in like 1 year, like four times what it was in like 1 year. Just in terms of like, I was just starting to shake hands. And the weirdest part about it was during that year, I was barely making anything. I had made like, let's just say I made 50 pieces the year before. In that year, during like being with the agency, I maybe had made like five garments.
This is personally, you personally, like your own thing. Is that what you're talking about? Mm-hmm. Gotcha.
I made like five garments, but I was out there doing stuff with all these companies. I was just meeting a lot of people, and they saw what I was already doing. And then in the midst of all that, like, let's just say I was doing denim. I went and did a job, and somehow Levi's was there. And Levi's saw my work through one of the people there. I've got a relationship with Levi's. And, like, I mean, literally, like, that was it. I just stopped doing agency work, and I went back to work with my brand. And now I'm here today, like, six collaborations in. So for a person to me, I think to take away from all that was like a person that's always creating somehow, some way, I don't know where you are, what market you're in. Just find the other creatives around you and network yourself and build those relationships. Even if it's not, maybe it's not even where you are, just online. Know the people that work for every magazine and every corporation. Like, I'm not talking about the big figureheads. I'm talking about everyone in the office. Like, do your research and build those networks and just slowly just integrate yourself. And somehow, some way, people will find what you do cool. They'll find that niche and they'll want to just kind of highlight it. That's what happened for me. And I don't know. That's the best way I could describe it.
No, that makes sense. I mean, it's crazy though to try to think of it in like a, you think about what you did and you think about how you did it, and then you go, okay, how can I try to explain this virtually? You know, so it's a different.
It's like impossible, right? Right. I don't think it's just more so like a, it's like a placement, like in the, like, you know, like I'm thinking of times right now, even as I'm describing it, and I'm like, there was no way anyone planned it. Like, there were moments, like, I was in L.A. for a job for, like, 3 months, and then one of my close friends is a rapper, and he was out there at the same time, and he's like, yo, come to the studio. And I ended up spending, like, a week and a half with Pharrell. This is, like, you couldn't place that. I was on another assignment in another country. Someone was wearing a jacket I had made months before at the same time, and it landed on Hypebeast. And that ended up pushing and amplifying something right where I was. Like, you can't really explain some of the things. It's kind of just energy and just, like, again, I think doing the work and eventually realizing, like, one day is going to pay off, because yeah, that's all it was. Because I used to psych myself out and say, like, damn, like, I'm doing all this work, but, like, no one's seeing you. Like, people aren't even liking it online. And now it's the complete opposite of that, you know? Just keep working and just eventually realizing that something's going to happen. That's the best way I could say it.
That makes, and it goes back to your, maybe not your saying, maybe the saying that I gave you, the craft over the person thing. Like, just keep it cranking, you know?
Yes.
I like that a lot. It sounds like Hector said, thank you, that was good. it sounds like you have, a lot of your advice was like, you got into the room, which is the hardest part sometimes, you know?
Hard.
So like, you've been around a lot of inspiring and creative people. So who has been a mentor for you, and what, like, why have you been like, oh, this person, I think about this person weekly. I thought about what they taught me so often in terms of a mentor.
I would say, most people notice, like, my friends. So my high school story is very simple. Came from Queens, went to school in Manhattan. And in the high school of art and design, it's pretty much like, it's a melting pot. Bronx, Harlem, Queens, Brooklyn, down everywhere. Like, all these kids from all these different regions, ethnicities, are just mashed up into this one school, and they're all artists. So when I went there, I met these four guys. They were all in the same grade. They all looked similar. Like, had wavy hair, and they all dressed like really bright colors. Jay West, Ferg, Juan Don, and LA the Rebel. And they were just like this clique, and I wanted to be just like them, be like accepted with them. I was 3 years younger than them, and we ended up being friends, and we're still together to this day. You know, Ferg ended up being a big rapper. His name is ASAP Ferg. Jay West is a painter. He's done a bunch of amazing stuff. Juan works in agency, and LA is a painter and a digital designer. Like, so we're all still doing the same thing. I would say the four of them, you know, Ferg really pushed me, because Ferg was the one that said, go into fashion. He's like, yo, we play with bows already. You might as well learn how to make them. You know, just all over all these years, it was just kind of my friends. Like, it was something we said on this interview. It was like, we always wanted to seek each other's approval. And me being the youngest, I always looked up to, like, my big brothers in a sense, and saying, like, I always want to do something to impress them. And I still do it the same way to this day. Like, we'll still share stuff with each other before we put stuff out, just to see, like, how we're going to react to it. Like, we're our biggest critics. So, I mean, yeah, I would say, like, the four of them. And somebody else, I would say, like, Carlton Yaito. You know, she's, like, the reason, like, I came to be where I am today. Because before I met her, I wasn't really doing much of anything. And she was, like, coming out of school, passionate, and I was just like, wow, like, I should get my act together. And it was just kind of the idea of being around somebody that had drive to want to do something, and then at the same time looking at myself and saying, like, wow, you have all this talent, you're not doing anything with your life. Like, you're almost like, not to say it to myself, like, yo, you're a waste. You know what I'm saying? Like, why were you blessed with these things, but you're not using them? So later on in life, she became, like, my biggest inspiration. Yeah.
And she's like an art director, but she's also your partner, correct?
Yes.
Shots to that.
Yeah.
To the people who are really driving us. That's amazing. Yeah. I love everything about this your whole story, this whole conversation, because what I've really realized is that you are all about the long game, or my friends like to say the long con, you know, because you're like slow and steady wins a race, you know, you're the tortoise in this, but it's really what we you know, preach on, and which is about, like, it's more so about the journey versus the destination. You know, you're like really, really enjoying the process of it all, and the process includes like you building your craft, building your skill set, you building yourself, and even like Dana, you telling us about your friends or your mentors, like those are people that you've met like so many years back. You're like over a decade year of friendship with them.
Yeah.
And that's like a beautiful thing to realize, because again, it's about the long con, like the long journey of it all, and really believing in yourself and investing in yourself to, you know, make it through, you know?
Yeah. I don't think anything else can, I you know, it's so funny. It's just so super left field and super random, but like, I felt like, I was late to the game, but I started watching Game of Thrones super late, right? I used to hear about all the hype, and
I binged it
for like 2 weeks straight. Like, I'm watching everything. The reason, like, everyone loved, like, Jon Snow so much, but my reason for loving him is kind of like the way I live my life. Like, there's characters that I really admire. Like, I'm a big Tom Hardy fan. Like, certain people, I look at them, and although they're in that light, and I guess the story for me of like Jon Snow was pretty much like, I saw somebody through like this journey of like turmoil, everything going on. You know, he never wanted too much power. He didn't really want much of anything. He just kind of wanted to exist and understand like who he was, you know what I mean? And then finding out who he actually was and all those things. To me, I feel like it goes right back to what we're talking about, trying to understand yourself and understanding that having that peace of mind can take you down any journey, and it will somehow help you be prosperous, because you're not looking for others for gratification, or you're not looking for some type of like validation through all of these things. You're just trying to be one with yourself, and that right there will push you through. And I don't know, just with that character, for some reason, that's what I always felt watching him. So
yeah.
That was like my point.
For someone who has been able to just like push through and work and find themselves, what does find your grind mean to you?
Sounds so repetitive, but I think this is the same thing I've said, like find your grind is like finding yourself.
Yeah.
You know, what am I going to do with my life? That you're pretty much asking yourself, like, who am I? You know, what makes you happy? You know, what drives you in life? And I think that's what find your grind is, just understanding yourself, understand what you want to do for the rest of your life, and knowing that you have a peace of mind while you do it. That's finding your grind.
Yeah.
So
how do we keep in touch? How do we keep following you? Like, how can people find you? Tell us your plugs.
Carlton Yaito on Instagram and Twitter. I don't tweet much, but I'll give you one or two thoughts every couple of months. And my website, carltonyaito.com. You can check me out there.
Following right after. Right now. I'll up in the DMs, just being like, hey, just going through something. How you doing? Can we just talk? I just need a good heart to heart. You busy? Hey, you up? I need a heart to heart.
And stop. I'm always done.
Okay. Hey, you said it. And everyone watching heard it as well. Everyone, thank you for watching this. If you're watching it live, if you're watching it later, doesn't matter. Thank you for being here and like sharing this experience with us. You can find more Find Your Grind here on Twitch 3 times a week. On Wednesday, we have the Educator Parent panel with our round table with our Rockstar squad. Thursdays are the mini lessons, and then Friday are more hangs with me and Charlie interview vibes on Twitch. Charlie, where can they find more Find Your Grind? I always say it like that. I think I need to find a different way because it's too many finds in one sentence.
You can find us at findyourgrind.com. We're all over on social, so you can find us on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube. You have me saying find now like every sentence. But I feel like while I was talking to Carlton, I was like, I wonder what his lifestyles are. Because for sure, your Leo personality definitely fits in how you execute things. But I know definitely you're a creator, definitely an entrepreneur because of Yaito, and probably an innovator because who else is killing the distressed denim game? So if y'all want to find out what your lifestyles are, take our free lifestyle assessment test now. We have a panel down below, but also go to findyourgrind.com. That is our show for today. Thank you so much to Carlton for spending so much time on us and giving us so much life lessons in this, 40-minute session. 40 minutes of insights and inspiration. So thank you so much, Carlton. We wish you all the best and can't wait for more work from you.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate it. This was amazing.
Absolutely. That is our show for today. Catch us again next Wednesday. Happy Friday, y'all.
How come I sing to myself all the time? Oh, it might be the only way to silence my mind. Cause I've been digging through my old emotions. You never seem to care. Running around back and forth. Are you even there? Do you ever even think about me? If you're waiting for an answer, I don't have a plan. So what do I say? What do I say? What do I say? Oh, I know my contradictive mindset. Oh, I can't help but wonder if I know you. Oh, I can't. Oh, I can't. What do I say? What do I say? What do I say? I'm losing my faith, losing my faith.
Thank you for joining us. Have a great weekend. Love you.